This post was taken down because of an anonymous complaint, correct? In the realm of in the realm of possibilities, Professor Arau, who could that anonymous person be?
You know, Carmina, your guess is as good as mine. Definitely, it's not Carmina Constantino. It's someone else. And that would be, perhaps, and I don't want to make wild accusations at this particular point, that would be those who are quite notorious for red tagging, not just, you know, ordinary journalists and individuals, but also demonizing those who are confirmed to be members and high-ranking officials of the Communist Party of the Philippines. So that includes the Tiangson Kokol. So your guess is as good as mine if you want us to venture into some scientific guesses.
So what are your options now, Professor Arau? You said a while ago that you were going to fight it, you were going to, you know, take a stand against this. So what's going to happen?
Well, just like the decision of the NTC to block Bulatlat and 26 other websites where we filed a case against, you know, the government institutions responsible for the shutdown of our website at that time, we filed a complaint with Facebook. We disagreed with the decision and we're awaiting a reply from Meta, which operates Facebook. So for now, that's what we're planning to do. But of course, there will always be a plan B if ever our request gets denied or we are further penalized for the practice of truth-telling that we've been doing for more than 20 years.
You know, this whole situation, right, can go both ways. I mean, on one hand, I know that you've been active as well in holding Facebook, Meta, to account as well for the spread of disinformation, right, that happened in recent years until you've become the target, until you're the one at the receiving end.
Yeah. Yes, that's true, Carmina, because what we call upon Facebook is not really to be too ultra-democratic for comfort. What we want it to do would be to practice responsible gatekeeping. I mean, don't get me wrong, Carmina, it's not hypocritical for us to uphold truth-telling on one hand and to encourage Meta to take down certain sources of disinformation, to even delete the pages, and I understand Facebook is doing that, but the problem is it's not enough. And sometimes those who get victimized would be individual journalists and news media organizations like Bulatlat. So the key word here, Carmina, is responsible gatekeeping, and which is what, unfortunately, Facebook is not doing at the moment, given that it is highly dependent on computer algorithm, on individual complaints, instead of having human intervention, particularly editors, really ensuring that those that are taken down or those that are being complained about would not be taken down. Mm-hmm. So that's what's missing right now.
Mm-hmm. I mean, just to digress a bit here, and you know the rise of AI, right, and the use of it. I mean, this is, and people have been talking about this recently as to, you know, the pros and cons of it. And when you zero in on this situation, this is definitely something that AI won't be able to thresh out on its own. Because, as you said, it's going to rely on algorithms and all that. And human understanding has to have a role here. Go ahead.
Yes, exactly. I mean, machine learning has its limits and it only uses natural language processing. So what does it mean? It can only mimic human communication, but the realm of critical analysis still rests in the human mind. There will come a time, don't get me wrong, Carmina, that certain artificial intelligence platforms will become sentient, meaning that it can make certain value judgments, but I doubt if we would rely on it too much. So we can use and maximize certain AI platforms, but we cannot be too dependent on it. So that's what we stress upon students, and in the same way, we stress upon social media platform owners like Zuckerberg to make sure that there is also the element of human intervention.
Now, I don't know what to call this, that this happened to you on World Press Freedom Day on one hand. On one hand, you could say perfect timing, right? On the other hand, you could say, what timing? So now that we're talking about what happened to Bulatlat on World Press Freedom Day, what does that tell you, Professor?
Well, it tells us that the struggle is real and that we still need to defend press freedom despite, you know, the semblance of normality, as some people would claim, and despite the fact that some government officials would claim that they are defending press freedom, because, you know, the saying, talk is cheap, and we still need to fight various terrains. It's not just the issue of denouncing the killings of journalists, the red tagging that's going on, and other forms of harassment and intimidation. There's also the weaponization of laws. Libel and cyber libel are still being used against us. Mm. In the case of Bulatlat, the Anti-Terrorism Act of 2020 was said to be the reason for the attempt to shut down our website along with others. So, you know, these things, Carmina, show that it's okay, whether you call it a coincidence or not, it's still, you know, symbolizes the fact that we still have a long way to go in terms of attaining the genuine democracy that we want so that we can practice the journalism profession in a way that we don't fear or worry about what's going to happen to us or to our family members if we are too responsible for comfort in the eyes of the powers that be.
But Professor, so far we've been talking about, you know, attacks from the outside, external threats. But what about threats from within? That's happening too.
That's a good.
And what do you think is the biggest? What do you think is the biggest threat to press freedom from within and among our ranks?
Well, internally there are a lot of major threats. So part of it, I'm sorry to say, would be media ownership, because certain media owners would tend to dictate content and the editorial direction of a news media organization. You know, of cases where news media organizations are owned by those who are very, very close to the palace, and some of them are even blood relatives of, you know, certain high officials of the land. So you understand why there is lack of criticality in the reportage of such news media organizations. But aside from that, advertising pressure and commercialism is also a problem. And on the other hand, it may take more than a semester to discuss this ethic. The observance of journalism ethics would also be necessary to ensure that we can further professionalize our rank. Mm-hmm.
But
so
only
there are a lot of layers. Yeah.
In the interest of time, because we're running short on time here, but all those things that you mentioned, Professor Aro, it's not as if all of these things happened overnight. That's been going on for quite a long time already. Question now is, what's the appropriate response coming from us?
Well, coming from us, we need to professionalize our ranks, observe the highest standards of journalism ethics, and it's closely related, on the other hand, to media corruption. I'm sorry, I forgot to mention that, but it's close to ethics as well. But on the other hand, we also need to challenge the current business models, because these things are very, very untenable. When you have media owners that have their own vested interests, and sometimes they conflict with editorial independence, then we have a very big problem. And of course, for the public, they should also acknowledge the fact that there are two traditions in the media. One is the dominant media and the other is the alternative media. Mm-hmm. So I'm sorry if I'm promoting an alternative media through a dominant media platform like yours, but we
no
coexist.
Worries.
Carmina, we coexist.
Of
and
course.
Such contents would also be necessary to be looked at by our audiences, because we promote plurality. It's not just loyalty to ABS-CBN. We have to also read other sources of information, which is what we need to raise the level of discourse and to provide more information to the public. The more, the merrier. Mm-hmm. So that's why we cannot shut down any news media organization like that certain news media organization that was closed down in 2020. We have to bring it back.
And finally, as you wrap up this conversation, Professor Aro, good thing that you mentioned that, because, you know, we got to talk about the messaging here. I mean, when you talk about World Press Freedom Day, the public may think that it's something that's alien to them, something that's so far from them. I want to hear about your message about how fighting for press freedom actually means fighting for theirs, too.
First of all, fighting for press freedom is a journalist's responsibility, because without press freedom, we cannot practice journalism. But at the same time, you're correct. This is the fight of not just the journalists, but also audiences and the general public. Why? Because press freedom is a cornerstone of democracy, and we wouldn't be able to get relevant information from the media if there is no freedom. And that's why we have to fight those who try to repress the media. So we have to remember the historical context as to why we are now commemorating the 30th year of World Press Freedom Day. It started with the UN Declaration in 1993, based on the Declaration of Windhoek in 1991, where we tried to develop and promote press freedom in certain regions in Africa. So right now, we have to continue the promotion of rights, including press freedom, so that we can be consistent with the historical origins or the roots, or historical roots of World Press Freedom Day.
Professor Danilo Aro there, Associate Editor of Bulatlat, also Associate Professor at the UP Department of Journalism there in UP Diliman. Thank you so much. Always a pleasure talking to you.